right, welcome to yet another edition of E4M Presents Thursdays with InfoBib, a specially curated series that focuses on various sectors with a core motive to deep dive and understand the latest as far as digital narratives and trends are concerned. Today's theme is decoding the digital influence in auto and consumer durable sectors. And the agenda is that we have a fireside chat followed by a panel discussion. So let me start introducing our first fireside chat that we have, the first thing lined up. The topic for this chat is journey from a temperate reality to a modern day experience. And joining the speakers on this panel are Mr. Sumit Asthana, General Manager, Samsung SDS, and the moderator would be Aravindan Somasundaram, Head Solution Consulting, InfoBib India. Thank you, gentlemen, for joining us. Over to you, Mr. Somasundaram.
Thank you, Rahul. Welcome you all for this wonderful event. Let's begin here. It is rightly said, the more things change, the more they stay the same. This is for our customer. The customer is always right. The customer is the king. These words will always remain true and intact. Even in the digital age, business still needs to do whatever they want, whatever they can to meet customer expectation and foster strong for poor services and lethargic resolution times. If business fails to meet their demand, they could see the disheartened customer jump towards competition. Further, customers today are aware of the hand they have to play in this dynamics. So with so many opinions available, they can afford to demand better services from business. If companies want to succeed in this environment, they have to not only meet customer demand, but exceed them. However, the customer experience and customer expectations are not the same thing. A great customer experience is the result of useful, easy, and enjoyable customer journey. To discuss this further on how the customer journey and expectations have evolved and changed over a period of time, we have Sumit Asthana, who heads technology at Samsung SDS. And let's understand this better with him. Hi, Sumit.
Hi, Arvindan. Good afternoon. Good afternoon to everybody.
Good afternoon, Sumit. Welcome and thank you for joining us.
Sure. So, thanks for bringing me here.
Same here. So shall we begin with the fireside chat, Sumit?
Let's go ahead. Yeah. Thank you.
So my first question to you, Sumit. Over the past year, there has been a shift in customer expectation. And as a result, the overall customer experience looks different and got transformed into a whole new world. There is more competition in the marketplace, which means the organization needs to do more to create personalized experience. What, according to you, Sumit, will take to reimagine this customer experience, and how can companies become institutionally empathetic so that the customer feels cared for?
Okay, so Arvindan, I mean, in India, what consumers really need, you know, as per me, is to have a look and feel, you know, of the product, what they are buying, whether they are buying like a mobile phone, or they want to buy like a car, or end of the day, I mean, anything for that matter, right? And unfortunately, due to COVID, right, a lot of people are becoming really cautious, you know, to kind of go to the stores and kind of touch, you know, the things in the stores, they really want that experience, you know, just sitting at home, right? And a fantastic thing which I saw in the past, I think a couple of months back, which Croma, you know, one of the retail stores, right, which has started in India, is giving, you know, the in-store experience while the people are sitting at home. So, I mean, if today I want to buy something, I really don't have to go to the Croma store. I can just go to their website. I can request that, hey, can you give me a demo or, you know, look and feel of the product. A video call kind of starts and you know, that look and feel can be given to the customer. The customer can ask questions. The same can be answered by the executive who is in the store and give that in-store experience. Well, that's one, you know, and other things like, you know, maybe the use of, you know, the AR, VR, the, you know, that can definitely bring in the change in the market trends. Because I personally, if you ask me, I mean, if somebody can give me a look and feel of a product while I'm sitting at home, I really don't want to go outside anywhere. I mean, that's what I can say is can really change, you know, the customer experience here in India.
Thank you, Sumit. So Sumit, you would agree with me that, you know, a communication is heart of human interaction and it can make and break a business.
Absolutely.
At InfoBip, we believe to have a great solution. We need to start with a strong insight about our customer that helps us understand how to communicate with them. Where does you feel that Samsung see an alignment with our belief and keep the pulse of Indian customers?
See, InfoBip has been really helpful, you know, in the transformation of what Samsung is in the journey of right now. And over the past year, more than a year now, we have this association with InfoBip. And it would really, I would say, you know, when we started WhatsApp, like around 10 months back, yeah.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
It was really a great journey, you know, where InfoBip has not only given us the solution, but has also given us the guidance in terms of how we can make our WhatsApp journey successful, right? And I'm really thankful, you know, to InfoBip and all the folks involved at that point of time. And also, I would like to explore more solutions. I know that you know, InfoBip has some, you know, the R&D team who's kind of working on more solutions. So definitely, you know, I would like to have more association with you guys in terms of what more we can do to bring in our customer experience, which is the most important thing at Samsung.
Thanks for the kind words, Sumit. Moving on to the next one. So delivering your message to its intended audience is the key essential to effective communication. You would agree with me. How are you delivering this information to those who needs it, especially in the era when customers are becoming more empowered to a selective, because they're selective in their approach? What tools and technologies do you think a B2C brand should use to engage customer with a value and that could add an experience? What do you feel so, or what do you have to say here?
Sure, Arvindan. So I would say, see, from a digital transformation perspective, you know, I mean, that is the most important factor, you know, for our market, for the B2C market, right? To kind of meet the customer's expectation. And given the situation of this pandemic, right? I mean, it really becomes very difficult for enterprises like us to kind of share the information needed, you know, to the consumers, to the customers. So we are really sitting in the digital era, right? I mean, the current era, you know, we can definitely eradicate, you know, the problem of engaging the customer by using the digital mediums and, you know, by SMSs or by using WhatsApp, you know, and looking at the Indian market or the Indian consumers today, Indian consumers is one of the biggest users of WhatsApp. Right. So, I mean, WhatsApp definitely, you know, I mean, Facebook has not allowed the sales, you know, WhatsApp as a sales channel till now. But there are, you know, kind of at least from a customer service perspective, if we are launching a new product, we can at least, you know, tell the customers or tell to our consumers that, yes, this is the new product what we are kind of launching in the market. Not kind of offering any discounts and stuff, but again, at least we can share the information, right? Sure. And then there are other OTT platforms, right, which we can use and which can really help us in passing on this information, you know, to the customers.
Right, Sumit. Right. So digital technologies, you know, have enabled completely the new customer journey, especially the big tech companies and startups today. You know, deploy these technologies, keeping in mind that they would change consumer behavior and continuously increase customer expectation.
Mm-hmm.
So according to a research of IDC, what we have seen is, you know, 2/3 of the CEOs of Global 2000 companies will shift their focus from traditional offline strategy to a more modern digital strategies to improve the customer experience before the end of year. With 34% of companies believing that they will fully adopt digital transformation within 12 months or less. So looking into the future, Sumit, what are some of the digital trends will make an impact in driving seamless experience so that the customer feels connected to the brand?
Good question. So I would say the very first thing which I would like to say is that, you know, and over the last year, as I've seen our customer service, you know, kind of shifting from voice to kind of digital mediums like chat and WhatsApp, I strongly suggest every organization should you know, adopt WhatsApp as a customer service channel. You know, I mean, this is what I can say, because I might have maybe 100 SMSs, but I might not have more than 100 WhatsApp messages, right? So, you know, even if you go by the study, right? I mean, a person kind of pick up the mobile in India, like, you know, more than whatever, 100-150 times a day, right? And kind of out of that 150 times a day or whatever that, let's take an example of 100 times a day, right? 90% of the times person checks, you know, the WhatsApp. Right. So that is one thing which definitely I would like to say that, you know, every organization shall adopt in terms of customer service, not sales, I would say, but at least customer service. And, you know, and then other than that, I mean, definitely social listening is very important, where we should listen to the customers, right? And respond to the appreciations, not only to the complaints, but definitely, you know, responding to the appreciations as well. So if customer appreciates, let's say I go on a Facebook, you know, and kind of appreciate some organization. So I, as a human being, you know, as a human tendency, I would expect that at least I'll get a thank you, right? So that impacts a lot, right? So that is important as well. And then Facebook Messenger is not that kind of popular in India as of now, but looking at the new Facebook strategy, I think they're going to be promoting Facebook Messenger, you know, strongly as well. So that's the third channel, which I would say, you know, which customers should adopt or organizations should adopt rather.
Agreed, Sumit. So touching upon the challenges, Sumit, we all know that staying digitally relevant through a seamless omni-channel approach will improve the customer experience. What do you feel is the biggest challenge holding back organization from delivering excellent omni-channel experiences?
See, coming from a technology background, I would like to say one thing that the biggest challenge what we see here in this industry is that, or any industry for that matter, is that when we start a journey, right, some years back, you know, nobody thought that WhatsApp will be that great of a channel, right? Nobody thought that, you know, people would appreciate chatting rather than talking, right? I mean, if you go like 10 years back, or maybe 15 years back, everybody would like to talk, right? Nobody would like to chat, right? So that way is in terms of business, I would say. And that's where the challenge kind of started, where people have adopted one technology for voice. Then when they kind of went further into the line, they kind of adopted other you know, technology for chat. Now WhatsApp coming, you know, the business coming in 2018, they adopted a different technology for that, right? So kind of, you know, giving an omni-channel experience is really important, because me as a customer, I would expect that if I called, if I chatted, if I sent a WhatsApp, you know, I am actually, for me, I'm sending it to the same organization, right? So the organization should know what I have talked, what I have chatted, and what I'm now, you know, what I'm now doing on a WhatsApp, right? So that is something really important, that this is really not an easy challenge to kind of overcome with, but definitely, you know, I mean, this is the biggest challenge, different technologies. So if a provider, you know, like one solution is definitely, you know, if a provider comes in and give you an omni-channel stuff, but then it doesn't make sense, you know, a company spending like millions, you know, maybe 2 years back, and now again, companies spend millions again to, you know, kind of consolidate all the channels. So yeah, I mean, this is what I feel is the biggest channel in terms of giving the omni-channel experience.
Thanks for sharing the challenge, Sumit. One last question from my end, given the time as the circumstances. What is Samsung roadmap on adoption of omnichannel journey? Take this engagement and experience to the next level, Sumit. Would you like to share?
As I explained, right? One option is if I get, maybe InfoBip can offer me something, if InfoBip can be the integrator of all my channels, that is one option. Then the other thing, which I can definitely see as an easier, adoption or as an easier implementation, is that what we do in our customer service is that whether it's a voice call or whether it's WhatsApp, whether the person is kind of walking in the service center, whether the person is chatting with us, our backend remains the same, right? I mean, all the information is getting fed in that backend by all sort of executives, whether it's voice, chat, WhatsApp, service center, anybody for that matter, right? So in our voice, definitely, as soon as the call comes, we kind of pop up the backend CRM. And that is also something which we are trying to adopt, for the other channels as well, so that at least the customer will get that personalized experience, and customers should feel that yes, I mean, this is the person I'm talking to, and he knows what I'm calling about, right? So that definitely, gives a good impact, a very positive impact on the customer experience.
Yeah. Thank you, Sumit, for your time. Just to summarize, digital technology has transformed consumer habit. Mobile apps, machine learning, automation, much more has allowed customer to get what they want, what exactly they need at that moment. What more, these new digital technologies have caused a small shift in customer expectation, resulting in a new kind of modern buyers. Today, the consumer are constantly connected over native apps and aware of what they can do with technology. Because of the opportunities that rise from using modern technology, customers often rate organization on their digital customer experience first. So, auto and consumer durable enterprises should look at digitalization as their core strategy, of course, as a core technology as well, to provide better customer experience and improve customer engagement. Thank you, Sumit, for joining us and enlightening the event for decoding the digital influence towards auto and consumer durable sector. Thank you all for joining, and stay tuned with our next session.
Thanks, everyone.
Hashtag digital transformation. Thank you.
Mr. Amit Tiwari, Head Marketing, Havells. This is our panel discussion. As I stated earlier,
is decoding the digital influence in auto and consumer durable sectors. Thank you, Mr. Tiwari, for joining us. Mr. Aniruddha Haldar, Vice President, Marketing, Commute, Motorcycles, Scooters, and Corporate Brands, TVS Motors. Welcome, sir. Deva Gosha, Vice President. Anjum, General Manager, Marketing, Honda Cars India. Shakti Upadhyay, Marketing, and taking this discussion would be Mr. Shankar Iyer, Consumer Success.
Thanks, Ruhil. Hello. Yeah, thank you. And thank you, gentlemen, for joining. Hello and welcome to all who have joined us today to discuss decoding the digital influence in the auto and consumer sector. It's a great pleasure to have this panelist for discussing such an important topic. Let me set the context here. The modern buying process has changed, right? I mean, right from an air conditioner to an automated car, it's something which we all know that the consumers take almost partial decisions online, and then try to authenticate that decision by visiting the dealers. This has been one trend. The other trend is about, interestingly, finding some third-party companies coming in play with some e-commerce capabilities, and then fastening with dealers who can offer some kind of great customer experiences. While manufacturers focused more on the omni-channel experience, we found that a lot of dealers focused on tactical solutions where they had a lot of data systems integrating with information and creating multiple touch points to various digital channels. While the revolution in the automotive industry evidently seen is more on the mobility and the connected services area, the digitally influenced sales in the consumer durable sector is expected to grow almost by 500%. As per BCG from 2018 to 2023. So for more insights about these data points, and as you all been seeing your customers, the behaviors and the experiences you've been having for the last 18 months, if I could say, pre-COVID, COVID, and some kind of post-COVID, it will be great to hear from you all on the trends which we will see going forward from now. Let me turn to my questions first, and I will probably ask Shakil to take my first question. Shakil, and I just want to focus on the point of segmentation of customers here. In a personal vehicle segment, especially, you know, you have a lot of segmentation of customers, which is a very key element for your marketing plans, especially physical as well as digital platforms. First question to you is there a major shift in segmentation with work from home being the new norm? And also, mobility is looked at more as a safety today than compared to convenience or luxury. And if yes, how do you see the plan and the approach for a personal vehicle manufacturers like you changing going forward?
All right. So thank you, Shankar. And good evening, everyone. And thank you for having me here. So let me break down the question into three small parts, and I'll be quick in answering them. The first part, Shankar, is that do we see a change from a shared mobility towards a personal mobility platform with work from home and with the fears of pandemic, COVID, etc.? A simple answer to this is yes. However, at this stage, it is very difficult to put a number to the size of this segment and whether this trend will hold. Why I so easily said yes is because there are two data points which are currently available, which is a significant drop of almost 80% in commercial vehicle registration and sales. There is a very significant drop in the sharing platform bookings. At the same time, after the lockdown got over, there is almost a 15% jump in personal vehicle registration. So clearly, there is a demand in the market. There are people who need a vehicle for personal use, and in spite of a general economic slowdown, they are willing to spend money. So demand exists clearly. The second part of your question is this, do we see a significant shift away from, say, luxury feature variants more towards utility and safety? Let me start with the easy, broad answer. It is no. To support this data point, we launched our most popular model City's fifth variant in July. And almost 55% of the sales in City have come from the top end of the segment, which is significantly higher than our previous launch. So clearly, the customer is giving equal importance to his bells and whistles. 50% sales are coming from automatic. So no, there is, at least in Honda's case, no major shift towards lower brand or the lower variants within the brand mix. And it kind of holds true for other models also. If we look at City, the major success stories, of course, have been the compact SUVs. Shakti is here from Kia. I'm sure he will be able to, you know, say this. Hi, Shakti, long time, in more detail. But the fact that Kia, Creta were able to sell million and a half price point vehicles in such large numbers shows that the industry is also not shying away from spending money and moving towards utility. Uh-huh. Third part, probably the most interesting, quickly, where do we see growth, or what can we do as an industry to look at this shift from shared mobility to personal mobility? So the shared mobility segment actually is, at least on a very broad level, in two parts. The first part, people who moved to a shared platform because of convenience, you know, parking hassles, managing your driver, cost of maintaining, etc. So they could have afforded a car, probably already had a car, but, you know, they felt confident because of the availability of the shared platform to utilize it. The second segment in that is more now generation. You may call them X, Y, Z generation, but the fact is, these are the people who do not want to invest significantly in an asset. They see this as a dead investment. They just want to use pay-per-use. So as far as the first segment is concerned, I think their fear largely rose from the safety viewpoint and convenience. industry rose to the question. I think everybody, including Honda, launched an online booking and buying service. We launched Honda from home, and it got incredible traction. We almost 2% of our bookings are now being directly through this platform, which is an eye opener for us.
And so I get your point. I mean, so I understand that, you know, and I hope that whatever you told us in terms of spending, it's not pent up and it is something which is an ongoing thing. There is a market for PV, which is not only for safety and convenience because of pandemic, but it is more of a preference and a choice. And I think I take that point. And the shift from shared to a personal mobility kind of an option. Moving ahead, you know, but I, obviously, you know, another discussion for lease model and the XYZ generation would require a different session. But take your point. Moving ahead, you know, I would request Deva to, you know, join us. You know, you're from consumer durable industry, and I wanted to understand from you on a holistic communication perspective, how is Voltas creating a holistic communication lifecycle by integrating channels, content, marketing around the customer from an engagement perspective, wherein, you know, you've seen that, you know, the physical engagement had taken a lot of it during the last 1 year.
Okay. Thank you for that question. And allow me to put Voltas into perspective first.
Sure.
That's a pitch I'll always make as a marketeer. So we are a 60-year-old brand, and we started the air conditioning business in this country in 1954. And since then, there has been no looking back. And today, we lead the industry in the cooling space. We not only sell air conditioners, we also sell air coolers and commercial air products. And recently, we also launched a wide range of home appliances under the Voltas Beko brand name. So I am saying this is because of the fact that taking a cue from what Shakil mentioned in the previous conversation, segmentation, for us, we have to cut across segments, right? And for us, we need to talk to housewives, we need to talk to house male, we need to talk to children. So that makes tasks much more wider for us. So keeping in mind our portfolio of products which we have, and which my friend Amit will also share subsequently, this portfolio has to cater to a larger cross-section of consumers. And that's where we have to cut across genders, we could cut across age, cut across SEC. And that's when engagement becomes very critical. Yeah. Because how do you engage with such a huge cross-section of consumers? So looking at, we took a look at last year during the peak of lockdown, and of immediate after lockdown, we looked at our media agencies. You know, there's a Havas Group's meaningful brand survey, which brought out very good insights for us. 61% of consumers were looking at brands to tell them how to use their appliances in the middle of a lockdown, middle of a pandemic. Okay, so that was very interesting, because instead of pushing propositions, features, RTBs, we thought, let's be simple and let's teach our consumers how to use their appliances, because they were looking for help. And that's when data and content came in for us. You know, we used the data of our consumer base, and we created meaningful content for our consumers in the middle of lockdown, and also when unlock started happening last year. And that helped us to stay engaged in a relevant manner. We didn't push down things on down their throat. And that's when it started. And we saw a huge amount of engagement, meaningful engagement taking place in all our social handles. And that helped us to stay relevant to the consumer's mind. We created DIY videos, which was, you know, how to service your air conditioners, how to service your appliances at home. And that was very meaningful for the consumers. Later on, when the festivals came up, we saw that there are some barriers to adopting categories. There was a pent-up demand, there was a replacement demand, but how do you ensure that consumers still come on board? So that's when we created content around consumer offers, EMI schemes, extended warranties. That helped us to stay relevant to the consumer. So a mix of data and meaningful content helped us to stay relevant and stay engaged with the consumers. This year, I think it should carry on. Data, content, search, and social will be our focus areas for 2021 as we move along.
Thanks, Dave, for the answer. And And just excuse me in case if you hear a little bit of background noise. Sometimes you've gone to virtual and working from home. Sometimes you carry these kind of things along. So please excuse me on that. My next question is to Anirudh, and probably we'll carry from the point where Shakil left. You know, the personal mobility space. In the pandemic, especially, we saw an increased demand for personal mobility. And India being India, you know, we know the two-wheeler space, which is so huge. And that is one of the major mode of private transport. How has TVS Motor engaged with consumers during this period, especially when you know that the walk-ins are going to be far and few in the dealership segment? And with that, have you seen a change in the buying process, especially in your segment?
Sure. Good afternoon. Thank you. And Shankar, that's a very interesting question. So as I get into that, let me just say that I think we are going to be looking at a new nomenclature of time very soon. And the BC would be before COVID, this would be during COVID, and hopefully very soon we will be in after COVID. While we are in the DC or the during COVID portion, we might be making a lot of projections on what after COVID will look like. And a lot of that learning comes from what we experienced. Some of the things that will probably stay, and a lot of behavior that we adopted in this period was a reaction of fear, was a reaction of caution, was a reaction of safety. Hopefully, some of them will maintain, but some of them will kind of fall away. Why did some of these changes come? So as you mentioned, personal mobility became about safety. Mass transit or the public transport system at that point in time had to shut down, but essential services need to carry on. And at that point in time, two-wheelers became a very, very critical dimension of it. And I'm very tempted to take Deva's leap and kind of give you a rundown of the portfolio of TVS. But much to say, we have something playing in the rural market, urban market, scooters and motorcycles. So we really saw demand interplay across the various categories. Very interestingly, the rural market, because just the mass transit shut down, there was a livelihood requirement. We saw the first upsurge that came in there. What we are seeing later on as we move along is that add-on vehicles started becoming important. So in urban centers, you may have had a car, you have had one two-wheeler in the family, the requirement for the second two-wheeler was coming on because you had individual mobility needs. So personal mobility did not, which was earlier almost defined like that of a family, was becoming very isolated. So when I go to work, what happens to my spouse? How is he or she going to this thing? All that interplay started coming in. So the demand natures started evolving. And staying true to the topic of the day in how the digital interface kind of helped in that period, is that initially we got into doing service videos, got into how to care for your vehicle when it is, you know, not mobile for a long time. But we realized as we quickly moved along that while there was initial uptick in that, what the consumer was really looking at was to say, how am I going to be taking care of it going forward? And to give a true sense of that individual mobility gives you this chance of social distancing, etc., being safe, and you really need that solution. So those kind of stories and content started playing out to be far better. We did our piece on booking online, and we got a fair amount of traction on that. But I still think there's a long way to go before that becomes really the mainstay. But interestingly, a trend that was always there, which is that you had to have seen or researched some of it online, the proportion of informed consumers walking into the showroom, that really leaped forward. So earlier, where you had 40-50% of people who were informed when they walked in, that number jumped to 70-80, respect to the kind of market or terrain that you're looking at. So the role of the dealership changed from information to validation, from providing, you know, solving the information gap to solving the assurance gap. So really the role at the dealership, role at the front line evolved, and hence the kind of retail aids that we needed to provide them to help them in the consumer journey, that also went through its change and digitization. So I think it's still very early days, and to, you know, your earlier question on segmentation that you had asked very interestingly, I refer back that post-COVID, there will be a whole different segmentation that will, even so we'll wait for the after COVID to see how that kind of shapes up. But it's interesting times ahead.
Yeah, absolutely, Anirudh. And I think I'll save some time for a question which probably talks about the AC which you mentioned. But taking a point from you which you mentioned, and I think that is more relevant for my question to Amit, where you mentioned about informed customer. And Amit, in Havells, for me personally, or for any consumer for that matter, operates in a category where touch and feel is so important, right? I mean, that's an area where you operate. And as a brand, how was your customer engagement involved in this scenario? Where as Anirudh mentioned, the decisions partially, if I have to put it that way, are made online. And the assurance, which the word he used, is given at the store or at the retailer. Give me some insight on that.
So, hi Shankar, good evening everyone. I think everybody has talked about their particular experience. And Shankar, as you rightly mentioned, if you see how does Havells operate, we operate around 32 categories. So even a pre-preparation of home till the final preparation of home that you actually use it, everything in every socket, you have something or the other that can be offered. Even the socket can be offered from what the Havells can actually put it. Partially, you're right, Shankar, in terms of that you require touch and feel. But actually, today what happens is consumer is much more informed than you actually think of. And I always believe in the fact that consumer is at least 10 steps more than all the marketers in whichever categories that you're actually operating today. What are we trying to fulfill? We are just trying to fulfill as an enabler to give him what he wants. All information, what he needs, he already trying to assimilate, irrespective whether you are not providing, somebody else will provide. What we have learned and what we thought of doing it in last couple of months is, we actually focuses on one particular science of marketing or science of entire social is about netnography. How does the netnography actually talks about each and every touch point of a consumer, how it is actually behaving, not only from an aspect of social listening, but also a very, very unbiased approach of what does consumer feel about. And that particular science has made us today, it is just a playbook for us, even for going for the next particular 10 months or 20 months or going forward. We have a basics in place now today. We know that it is not about only a pent-up demand. No, this is a combination of future as well as present needs that are actually moving for it. Coming to the touch points that you talk about today, what we are actually trying to fulfill, we're just trying to be as an enabler. If you, let's say, in a water purifier as a category, if you want somebody to have a service, we will help you out in terms of either through a virtual call or through a video call or WhatsApp call. You may not be having a direct access to the call centers because call center is not operating, things are not moving across, but we can reach out to you whatever form and format to look for. If you see, largely most of the, around 85% of the business on the consumer appliances as well as the entire consumer durable runs on a very traditional format, dealer, distributor, retailer, where the trust is not in terms of who is selling. The trust is, how are you actually selling? This guy will give you a trust, the dealer will give you a trust because you buy, I'm sitting here in terms of whatever the need is required. That we've actually tried to fulfill by generating leads to those particular propositions. We created a concept called O2O, which is online to offline. So we were creating and generating leads for all our dealer and distributors. They were actually fulfilling that order because, for example, if Shankar is in XYZ part of the country and he wants a requirement for an AC, how would that be fulfilled? So we'll show him three options. He can buy the same price and he can actually go and the dealer can deliver and fulfill that entire particular order. The idea is, if at this particular point of time, if you can actually engage a part of your particular consumer journey, I think you're actually winning a consumer in much way. Also, what I heard from most of the other panelists, I don't know, Rohil can actually come in. I don't know how these two animals of consumer durable and auto can come together. I couldn't make it out since the day I think Infobib and Rohil can actually find out. But the larger piece is, digital is no more a medium. And that's what I've been telling. It is a part of life for anyone. If me as a consumer, for you, and from a 6-year-old to a 60-year-old, everybody thinks that it is part of life today, irrespective of whatever journeys that you actually bring in. That is how the evolution is happening. Thanks.
Yeah, You've accelerated the point of saying that, the last point which you made, that it is part of the life. I think the opinion is that it has got accelerated much more than what it was. And that acceleration brings in a lot of new dimensions to the marketing and sales. And to the point where you said how consumer durable and auto can go together, I'm sure it is not going together on that acceleration at least. But for the part of discussion, yes, we're trying to bring it together. And thanks for that answer, Amit. Moving ahead, coming to Shakti, and I think, very interestingly, I want to ask you, probably you were exactly born kind of, you know, VC, and you know, you were during the COVID is where you were establishing your place, and then now you have a position to take. So I'm referring to your last 18 months. I know I understand you came around 19 August during that period, and you know, it's been three launches after that. And so my question more is, you know, to understand how have you been recording your customer feedback, which is a very, very key element, right? For you to, you launch yourself and you want to know how your customers are reacting to it. And the time of that feedback capturing period was so tricky, isn't it? So I just want to understand, how did you manage to get your voice of customer and really understand what went well for you and what is that you can do considering the times where you were in the market?
Thanks for an amazing question, Shankar. Hi, everyone. Good evening. Actually, as you pointed out, we are the youngest on the panel in terms of all the brands who are present here. But we have seen the three parts of life. Like when we started, it was everything was going smooth. We were doing great. In 2019, we were happy that, okay, we have been getting a little bit of success. Immediately, then COVID happened, and now here we are. In terms of all these three eras, as Anirudh mentioned, we have launched three products. Now, as all of us know, Kia has been a very late entrant in Indian automobile industry. It was quite a big challenge, and it actually became an opportunity for us. The answer to your question goes real back when we started planning how to bring the brand in India. The entire Kia product portfolio, the brand positioning was decided and designed keeping the new age consumer in mind. And since beginning, through our interesting narrative that we had for the brand, you know, the tiger, the astronaut, the badass with Seltos, we have been taking a very different take with the consumers. Now, what that brings us to is that today consumer is more friendly than us, than anyone else. The best part of the new age consumer, the person that I'm targeting as a brand, is that he loves to express and he talks back, and digital is definitely a boon. Now, being in a high involvement category, every emoji, every comment or every interaction that he does on my channels is an opportunity for me. And we started doing the activities much before Seltos launch. For example, when Seltos was launched in August 2019, we were busy building the brand since October 2018. And since then, we have been speaking to the consumers in a very positive way. The first part was to get this entire, following of the new age consumers to listen to them and then to come back with a product and the overall brand promise. For example, Seltos was buyable online from day one. When we were looking at in the booking period, we were buyable online from day one. This brought us to the second phase, which is when we were planning for Sonet. And exactly at that point in time, COVID happened. But as I said, going back to the entire philosophy, how we have geared up for the market, we realized that work from home was actually buy from home, and that was something which was a boon for us. With the quirky, engaging and digital first approach that Kia has had, we have been striking a chord with the new age consumer so that he is the most vocal with us. For example, the entire Sonet launch was conceptualized and it was done in the COVID period. But on day one, we got more than 6,500 online bookings. So in a way, I would say COVID was a boon for us. It brought us even closer to the consumer. Coming to the third part of your question, we were saying how much is it important to catch the trend and ensure positive VOC. As a brand, I would say Kia has not catched the trend. We have been creating a trend and we've been ensuring a positive VOC even before the trend catches up. For example, during COVID, while everyone was sullen, the mood was not good, everyone was worrying, Kia came up with a campaign which made people just to sit back and relax. We said we did not even advertise our products. We had launched Carnival, in which there was a TV commercial where the main protagonist goes out of his palace to meet his girlfriend on a beach, we just reverse the TVC back. And we say, rewind Kia. Now that's the power of the word Kia because it's colloquial as well. So rewind Kia, and then we said, you stay back, stay relaxed. At the back of it, we launched programs which were giving people wellness ideas, which were letting them do the best with their cars, which were stationary. And that's how we even managed to come closer to the consumer. But yes, we have been recording the feedback at each and every moment, and we have been putting it in our products in the way we communicate. So,
yeah, got it. I mean, you answered my question, and I think my focus on that question was more understanding, while you were born digitally, and it helped you capturing those information. But these were tough times to actually assess, customer behavior, right? Because there were no normal times, people behaved differently, and we heard that from all of you. I think with such a large panel, I can only afford having one more question, but I'm going to toss up a question with each one of you, a same question and your quick opinion on that. While there are trends, I believe you touched upon some of the trends which will continue. Some are irreversible trends. Some trends started before COVID, which probably you would give it to your digital adoptions and things like that. But the major question still remains is, we keep talking about a rural market, which is much bigger in India. That's a market which everyone wants to chase. But bringing digital to rural market, and that's where my question is, that do you see an ecosystem which is digitally equipped, ready for you to bring disparate systems and functions within your organizations to connect with or probably create a customer engagement hub and connect with new customers, customer relationships, digitally connect customers, track customer behaviors, put in a lot of those AIs and analytics. So what I'm trying to ask you is, do you see an ecosystem which is like ready where you can now scale up to rural markets and make it a little big because it is digital now? I'll start with Amit.
So Shankar, two parts to the question, the two answers. First is, we already have a real-time marketing center, which actually takes care about the entire ecosystem of all the consumers and customers that we actually talk about, both B2B and B2C. And it's a very, very fairly large structured and unstructured data that we actually evaluate and do it. Going to rural, I think there's no option. And I think you should go. And if you see the trends, what is there during the COVID, also when the lockdown was starting, the first particular market that had actually started moving are all the markets which are already semi-urban and rural markets to it.
Right.
It is not a matter of infrastructure. It is also a matter of what is the level of interest that you can actually able to suffice, what category you can actually move it to it, and what is the power of product and what is the pricing that you can actually go for it. So I think it's not a matter of in terms of it's a huge market. People have already explored that market. Obviously, one size doesn't fit for all. So whatever you're doing for your urban market, you definitely have to carve with a new particular strategy for going forward. And a lot of insights which other particular brands are doing, because your insights will help you in terms of driving in those particular markets. That's my answer to it.
So Amit, you're saying you're in. You're saying that the ecosystem is in place. It's your prerogative how you want to drive
Absolutely.
Okay, perfect. Anirudh, your thought.
Yeah, just before I get onto that, I can't resist answering Amit's earlier question of why auto and consumer durable together. So I have a product that plugs into the wall, charges on electricity and runs fine. That is as appliance I get. So the TVS IQ is exactly what, and this thing probably uses a Havel socket while it's at it. So we are very much closer to tomorrow than you think.
At least there's some particular monotony breaking has happened to the entire, it looks like a so serious discussion that at least we are trying to change the policy for India for consumer durable automobile. So I'm thankful, I'm glad at least I'm able to make that difference to the entire communication today. Thanks, Anand. Thanks Anand for participating in that.
Coming back to the question that you talked about, the rural market, I think the rural market is already digital. It's we were catching up to it from a content perspective. Enabling transactions, that's a separate, that doesn't mean they're not digital. They're consuming content in droves. There are already enough number of platforms out there which is servicing them. Are we transaction ready? Are we willing to completely complete the end-to-end transaction in rural? Maybe not. But are we transaction ready in urban centers also? I don't think we're 100% there. But good to say that you already see, I mean, examples like Shakti with Kia, which is very strongly on the digital. We have a couple of products which are in our minds digital first, where our campaigns rarely go on TV for that. We have booking engines which are working online, TVS IQ, Bentalk, these are all working online. Bulk of our business on that comes in. Are we transaction ready? I think we can do better on getting transaction ready. There are regulatory environments that prevent us to do that 100%, and there are others. But at some point in time, that is enablement. Even after you enable that, even after, for example, fashion went online, people would still want to walk in and check out the size and fit and then go back and order it online. The act of shopping, the experience of shopping is still something you can't take away. So I think we have to be very careful in what we provide and what we take away. And while we are transactionally ready, we do not really take away the joy of bringing home your next appliance, vehicle, car. I think it's an intrinsic part of that joy of bringing in something like that, which will still remain. And we should be very careful in protecting that.
All right. So we are ready with digital ecosystem. I mean, consumers are digitally equipped, but transactionally is what we are looking at as a space to be enabled. Let me turn to Deva, you know, your views on this from a consumer durable product.
Great. Since you're short of time, I'll just sum it up quickly. I think this our category is already there. 45% of the durable business is already there in tier 2, 3, 4 towns. So we are selling there already, and the consumers are already there who are adopting us. What is more challenging for us is how do we engage with our trade partners in these towns? Because that's how we want to digitize ourselves, because we have a multi-level channel of distribution, right? So we don't reach out to consumer from our own exclusive brand stores, which automobile companies do. And so we have to depend on a multi-level channel of distribution, and that's how we have to engage with our sub-dealers also, you know, to ensure that they reach out to their consumers end of the day. That's an important priority for us. Secondly, in terms of driving generic demand for new categories, we all know refrigerator sells in a cooler sell in upcountry towns. But what we didn't know was dishwashers, which we launched last year, 40% of our sales came from upcountry towns. Amazing. So we never knew that consumers are open for new technology, new offerings, and that's where we triggered our demand. So it's important to align with your trade partners so that whatever you do, at least they're able to fulfill that. That's my take on upcountry priorities.
I think along with transactionally enabled, you also want the trade ecosystem to also be digitally queued to get those. I mean, probably it is very interconnected with the transaction point, which Anirudh mentioned. Shakti, your point, and then I'll come to Shakil. On basically, you know, looking at the digital ecosystem readiness for rural market.
I'll be very quick to answer in the interest of time, but I cannot resist this small chat between Anirudh and Amit that I was listening. So Shankar, you have the bridge between consumer durables and automobiles here in your panel. I've been with consumer durables for 8 years, selling televisions, and now being with Kia.
So I sold a couple of cars also.
That's good. So all I can talk about is, see, as a brand, we are fairly new in terms of penetration. We are in the penetration mode. But what I can tell you is that India is not digital ready, or the penetration is lower at the, in some of the suburbs or when we say upcountry. That is something that I feel is a myth a little bit, because for example, in Kia, we had launched a service app through which you can book the service from your home. The driver will come, pick up your car, he will take it back, and as he's going, you can even watch your car going on the map. Then he services it. The service estimate comes on your app, you approve it, you reject it, you change, then you pay on the app. And then the car is delivered to the home back. I'll be delighted to tell you that more than 90% of the services that we are doing in Kia that are being done digitally, and the kind of traction that we are getting from non-metro towns, that's amazing. So that's the yardstick that I will keep.
Sure. Shakil. From you, and then I can probably take one more audience question. I think we have 4 minutes. Yeah.
Sure. So very quickly, I think very interesting perspectives. In terms of infrastructure, I think everybody's ready. I don't see a divide in rural and urban. It depends totally upon that the infrastructure and data is in one place. What are you going to do about it? So in our case, very quickly, my focus at least in how can I utilize my existing customers and the prospects, make them talk to each other and let my existing customers convert the prospects. So that is the data point and the digitization that I'm looking for, including using my existing customer gift as well. So any use cases, this is my focus. Thanks.
Okay. So use cases, transaction, trade readiness, probably consumers are far ahead in terms of consumption of digital mode. You know, these are some of the things which probably are there. And I think probably in a year down the line, a conversation like this would probably be talking about how the new use cases are building from these tools and technologies or the availability of resources. I have a question from the audience, and I think the question is more related with a consumer durable kind of scenario. So I think Amit and Dev both can come in case we have time. The question is, it is mentioning about digital transformation and social listening. I think Sumit mentioned during his conversation, I think Amit also mentioned about it. So Amit, you can take it first. Digital transformation and social listening, are any of your segments using the programmatic marketing or advertising techniques based on user behavior for your brands in social media? So it's basically talking about user behavior getting used for marketing in social media.
So just to answer on this, Shankar, I think today most of the digital planning happens primarily on programmatic, and you can see a lot of different results. But also just a caveat, it also depends upon category to category and what's the objective that you're actually trying to do. For example, in a category, again, like a water purifier versus an AC, the objective is very, very different. Yes, there are on the basis of behavior, you do programmatic buying and it is very, very relevant today. It helps a lot of things in that. Deba, if you want to add something on this.
No, you're bang on. Programmatic is actually a staple diet for us now because it's going to be there for some time. So if you want to devise your social media plans and your digital plans, it has to be embedded in. Goes without saying.
Yeah. Okay. So thanks for Shreyas Ranjan for asking this question. I think you know you got an agreement from the panelists that yes, it is the key area of focus. I think that just brings to time. I was wondering if I have five of you, how am I going to manage it? But thank you so much for actually supporting me on that. And I think I'll just quickly summarize our very interesting thoughts which came across from shared to personal. Probably consumption is there, but we need more transaction enablement, trade, digitally born businesses, and some interesting connects and collaboration between consumer durable and auto industry for the event companies to know that this is there to stay. So really appreciate your thoughts and time, gentlemen. Thank you so much, and I hand it over to Rohan.
Thanks, Shankar.
Thank you so much, everyone, sharing your insight. And we hope to, and thank you for everyone who asked the question in the audience, and we'll come right next week and see you soon on InfoBip, E4M Presents InfoBip, Thursdays with InfoBip, and a new topic. Thank you again for your time.